Okay, let's get started. I'll start with a time check. It's 25th of March at 2 p.m. in Singapore, and I'm delighted to welcome all of you. I know I think people are still entering the room, but I'll start with the introductions. On behalf of the Sing Health Duke NUS Global Health Institute, I'm delighted to welcome all of you today. I am Amina Mahmood, Deputy Director of the Institute, and this seminar is part of our monthly seminar series. We bring topics of importance in global health to our audience with the idea of building a global health community, both within Singapore as well as in the region. Reflecting that, we also tend to invite people from Singapore as well as in the region, and we hope to really reach a wide audience through this. These seminars are usually hosted on the last Friday of every month, as we are today. Although there are some times when we have to adjust that, so do look out for our invitations and our EDM blasts. So our speaker today is Professor Lee Thee Hong, who is the Dean of Institute for Preventive Medicine and Public Health, Hanoi Medical School. After graduating from Hanoi Medical University, she obtained a PhD in Nutrition, Food Technology, and Biotechnology from Wageningen University of the Netherlands. Since then, she has accumulated a wealth of experiences in conducting research on HIV/AIDS, environmental health, nutritional science, community health, primary healthcare, and communicable and non-communicable diseases. As you can see, these are all very relevant global health topics, and we really look forward to her talk today. In addition to being the Dean of the Institute of Preventive Medicine and Public Health, she's also a professor at Hanoi Medical University and the Health of Nutrition and Food Safety at the Institute. She has mentored more than 40 masters and PhD students, both from Vietnam and internationally. She is currently the chair of the Southeast Asia One Health University Network Foundation Board. She is also a co-chair of the Subcommittee on Innovations and Impact on Clinical Practice of the upcoming World One Health Congress 2022, which is being organized by SDGHI. Her talk today is directly relevant to this topic of the World One Health Congress and how we must apply a One Health lens to tackle current and future pandemics. I really look forward to her presentation. And before I hand over to her, a few housekeeping notes. As you know, this webinar is being recorded. Please keep yourselves on mute at all times. And you can post questions in the chat box at any time, and she will look at them at the end of the presentation. So over to you, Professor Lei.
Thank you very much, Nima, for your introduction. And hi, everybody. So I'm very happy today to be able to be with you to share with you about the topic in One Health. Okay, so my topic is applying a One Health approach to tackling the next pandemic. My presentation will focus on four parts. First one, we will understand the pandemic. As a pandemic is the challenge of the world, and pandemic that threaten our and the root cause of the pandemic. The second part, I will go through the evolution of One Health. Okay, so I continue. So the first one, I go to the One Health tackle the next pandemic, and I will talk about the preventing future pandemic. What more could be done? And global effort in One Health. And the last part, I will talk about the example of One Health. So first, we talk about what is a pandemic. So we will differentiate between the epidemic and pandemic. So what is epidemic? So we know that an epidemic is an outbreak of the disease that affects mainly in a population and begins to spread rapidly. An outbreak of the disease is considered an epidemic if it affects a certain number of people within a short period of time, typically within a 2 weeks. So what is a pandemic? Pandemic is a large epidemic. A pandemic covers several countries or spread from one continent to another. In pandemic outbreak, the number of people affected or killed doesn't matter as much as the rate of spread and how far it has spread. So So I as we back to the history, in the past year, we can see different outbreak that happened in the past, like the measles pandemic that affected 200 million people, or smallpox is caused affect to more than 300 million people, or Spanish flu, it affect 50 to 100 million people. And now it is a time that the whole world, we have to deal with the COVID-19 and some other more as in the screen that you can see. And we recognize that the pandemic caused by the zoonotic disease. As the figure you can see in the board, that 60% of the existing human infectious disease are the zoonotic, and 75% of the immersed infectious disease of humans, like Ebola or HIV or influenza, have the animal origin. So we also estimate that 80% of the Asian with the potential bioterrorism use are the zoonotic pathogen. And we also see that 5 new human disease appear every year with the animal origin. And with the COVID-19 in Southeast Asia, you can see the different color. So the number of cases increased through 2020-2022, and it's increased very much in 2021-2022. And now the number in very high prevalence happened in the blue one, Malaysia, Indonesia, Philippines, Thailand, Vietnam, Myanmar, and other. And also we see that in Southeast Asia, we have a different type of the COVID-19. And now we see how it affects to our economic situation. So the during 2002-2003, the economic loss due to the SARS reached $11 billion. And the estimated economic impact of the communicable disease on human, animal, and cropping is more than 41 billion annually. In 2018, global spending on health reached 8.3 trillion, or 10% of global GDP. And it was the first time in the past 5 years that health spending grew slower than GDP. In low-income countries, infectious disease accounted for half of overall health spending, while in the middle-income country, they accounted for one-third. That is a different, significant difference. The ASEAN Development Bank latest impact assessment released in 2020 estimated global loss due to COVID-19 to be 5.5% to 8.7% of the GDP in 2020, and 3.6% to 6.3% of world GDP in 2021. So what is the picture in the future? If we look for the year 2050, so to meet the need of the growing world population, over 83 million people per year, food demand will increase by more than 40% by 2030 and 70% by 2050. And nearly 70% will be in the urban. And economic will be increasingly consumer driven, and livestock production will more than double globally. That is an increased environmental impact. And you can see that the current COVID-19 pandemic in 2022, the mass consumption, 3 million masks per minute, in 2022, and it increased 9,000% compared to the previous. And globally and intra-regionally connected human, animal, plant, environmental health, and well-being are intrinsically connected. So now we can see that the threat of viral outbreak will grow rapidly. As we can see back to the 18th century, we have a Spanish flu, it affected to 500 million people infected. And H3N2, it's affect about 700 infected people. And then HIV, about 70 million. And then H1N1, 2 billion. And now COVID-19, the new data show that in the global, COVID-19 affect almost 500 million people. And it caused about 6 million people dead due to the COVID-19. That is an example of fully realized pandemic. And below, you also can see the example of outbreak that didn't have a pandemic or global epidemic potential like Nipah, SARS, Ebola, or MERS, or H7N9. And here we see that the 70% of new communicable disease in human originated in animal. And out of the estimate, 150 to 300 communicable disease in human, 65 to 70% originated in animal. And climate change and environmental degradation. So pandemic risk and its driver. In the screen, you can see that the cause to this problem is deforestation and other land use change. So you see the man cut the tree, and antimicrobial resistance cause a lot of trouble because of using antibiotics in wrong way. And we also see that illegal and poultry regulated wildlife trade is also a big problem. And intensifying agriculture and livestock production, and also the climate change. All these things happen in every country, in every region, and it caused the whole global problem. So what is process, we can talk about the driver of pandemic risk. We start with the outbreak, and bigger it will be the epidemic, and more bigger is the pandemic. At the outbreak level, so emergence, what is called the outbreak? It is due to the human encroachment or exploitation, translocation, climate variability, and vector density and distribution, and ecological pressure. So that is the factor cause the outbreak. And how about the epidemic? You can see the amplification of the urbanization, population density, agriculture and intensification, technology and industry, vector distribution and densities, transmission in healthcare center, and even more for the pandemic, it is a globalization level, that global travel. So nowadays people, animal, vector can travel over the world, and global trade, animal and their product also all over the world. Here, we will see that we need to have a multi-sectoral and multi-discipline collaboration. Why? When we talk about the health, especially about the One Health, it is the principle of the multi-collaboration, multi-discipline collaboration. Many different disciplines have to be involved in the One Health, like biophysical and environmental driver, terrorism, or political, or medicine, and all these things will affect to the through the non-food system or personal determinant of food choice, that we all, under the interaction of plant food production or animal production and transportation of aggregation, storage, processing, distribution, and consumption, is very dependent on the behavior of the people, and it lead to the environment impact or territorial balance and equity impact, socio-economic impact, and food security and nutrition and health. So now we see evolution of One Health. That is a defined a strategic framework for reducing risk of infectious disease at the animal-human ecosystem interfere. This strategic framework focuses on the disease surveillance, emergency response, and collaboration with the communication between the public health and animal health domain, that is the interaction. So the approach One Health system from the original theory of One Medicine, developed in 1984 by Calvin in his book titled The Veterinary Medicine and Human Health, advocating a combined medical and veterinary approach to zoonotic disease. So what is One Health? That is the concept that not very new, but also not old. So One Health is the collaborative, multi-sectoral, and transdisciplinary approach, working at the local, regional, national, and global level, with the goal of achieving optimal health outcome, recognizing the interconnection between people, animal, plant, and their shared environment. So One Health reflect the relationship and interaction between the health of human, animal, and the environment, with the ultimate aim of protecting human health. And a One Health approach emphasizes intersectoral collaboration and coordination in order to improve the health of human, animal, and environment. So in the chart, you can see three rounds. It is human health, animal health, and environment health. And the One Health is in the middle. So when we talk about the human health, the different factor effect to the human health, like a diet, security of food, or social determinant, or food population movement. When we talk about the animal health, it is related to the security of food, or antimicrobial, or disease, vector-borne disease. And also when we talk about the environment, it is the climate change, water pollution or air pollution, or deforestation or biodiversity loss. So the One Health is the combined between the human health, animal health, and environmental health. And this also, we can see the different discipline involved in the One Health. At the in the top, we can see that for the animal health, we have the veterinary medicine, we have a comparative medicine, we have a human medicine for the human, and also we have a biology or ecology related to animal health, or we have a social science humanity related to human health. And for the environment, we have engineering or earth science. And the below chart, we can see that it is a different issue contribute to the One Health. If you look at the driver, we have how is land use, climate change, economic development, or globalization, or energy extraction and use, migration. That is all the issue under the driver. And what is the influence to the One Health? It is a culture. Different country, we have a different culture. Different ethnic group, we have a different culture. Or economic, or policy, or behavior, or education. All these things affect to the One Health. And under, we look at the problem. What is the problem that One Health we focus on? It is zoonotic disease emergence, or pathogen distribution, or health disparity, food and water safety and security, poverty, loss of the biodiversity and wildlife habitat, environmental contamination, and diagnostic limitation. That is all the problem or issue that One Health will look at or focus on. So the strategy to combat the pandemic, we start with the transparency communication. That is a very important one. If we do not make it transparency, the information, we cannot deal with the pandemic. Every country, every region, and at the global level, we need to transparency communication, or we need to share the information. And also, the second important is evidence practice, that every intervention, every plan, we have to base on the scientific evidence. And then the pandemic preparedness plan. So we need to prepare for the pandemic. Even in the normal situation, that we have to imagine, or we have to make a plan. If the pandemic happens, what will we do? So we have to prepare for it. We have to prepare the human resources. We have to prepare the facility and also other things for the combating the pandemic. And now we talk more about the digital technology. So we have to apply the digital technology on the combating with the pandemic. And universal health compass, that is the upper level. So we hope that our world will be like a flag, and we can share information easily. We will get information very quick, and we can work together to combat the pandemic. Now, why One Health is important? We know what is One Health, and now we talk about why One Health is important. Because as Earth population grow, like the slide before I just mentioned, every year the population increase about 83 million people in the world. So our connection with the animal and the environment also changed. Now, we see that people live close together because of the crowded or increase of the population, but also the land limited. That's why people live close together. And also beside that, we can travel easily from this country to other country. And the second thing is the change in the climate and the land use. So the temperature increase every year. And also the change in the land use, the cultivation land is reduced. And we use land for the factory, and more global travel and trade. So easily to traveling, but it also costs a lot of problem and the trading. And animals are more than just a food. So we can see that now many raising animals with different purpose. These factors make it easier for disease to spread between the animal and people. So a One Health approach Tekler share health threat by looking at all and the human, animal, plant, and environment. Why adopt an on health approach? An integrative multi-species and approach to healthcare may bring tremendous benefit in our understanding of concept of on health and into tackling steps to address it holistically. So on health may result in more information sharing between those working in the disease detection, diagnosis, and education and research. And it may lead to the high interdisciplinary program and education. And on health can create more intervention level and new methods of fighting vector-borne transmission can also be based on microbial symbiosis. And we might develop new eco-inspired therapy and approach to treat. Nature can provide innovative solutions that use the property of natural ecosystem service. The ultimate goal of One Health is to identify opportunity for health improvement and risk mitigation across all three domains. So now we analyze what is a stakeholder involved in the One Health. So as we mentioned before, that mainly stakeholder involved in the One Health as the donor, international organization or university, the policymaker at the regional level, national or international level, or veterinarian, animal healthcare worker, food processor, animal husbandry specialist, socioeconomic expert, public health authorities, researcher and scientific, ecologist, wildlife specialist, or student. It is a very important for the next generation, farmer, community, etc. So under the umbrella, you have a different sector, different field, different of the people involved in One Health. And here it also analyze the One Health approach that we involve in different area. So what is that? So for the, when we talk about the intersection of the human health, it is the animal health. So for the animal health, we work on the neglected tropical, laboratory capacity development, hygiene standard, and foodborne infection and contamination. When we talk about the intersection human health, it is the environment. So we have to monitoring a wide animal risk bias. And we also monitoring and regulation of the market early warning system. When we talk about the infection environment, that is animal health. Vector spread as a result of the climate change and water contamination through animal slaughter. When we talk about the infection of all the three sectors, that is a zoonosis with pandemic potential, antimicrobial resistance, and digital early warning system or interoperable database. So that is what One Health focus on. So what we can do for One Health or One Health required? First one is a better coordination. So how we can do better coordination? That is a map and understand the connection, information flow, and responsibility of the relevant stakeholder who need to collaborate. And we focus on joint prevention, better understand the driver and mechanism of pathogen spillover via integrated risk assessment. And we have to share information, share the database, and coordinated field surveillance activity, share the knowledge, more joint research effort that aim to achieve a deeper understanding of broad species disease transmission and comparative medicine. And we also need to share the funding, share the public and private partnership to develop and evaluate new diagnostic methods and vaccine in order to prevent disease that cross between the species. So, what is the One Health approach? Through the security agenda, we see that global health security, we focus on three fields. First one is prevent. So how we can prevent? We have to focus on antimicrobial resistance. That is a very popular. The second one is zoonotic disease. And the third one is biosafety and biosecurity. And the fourth one is immunization. That is what we can do to prevent. And for the detection, what we can do, we have to strengthen the national laboratory system, real-time surveillance, reporting system, workforce development are very, very important to be help to detect the pandemic. And for the response, what we have to do to be able to respond to the pandemic. So we do the emergency operation center we need to set up in every country, linking public health with law and multi-sectoral rapid response, and also medical counterpart measure and personal development action packet. That is very important for training for human resources. And now we analyze a bit more about the animal science, human health, and environmental science at the core of the One Health. So here we can see how we enter the One Health. We enter the One Health by doing research, by education, by workforce development, and by community outreach. What area we focus within the One Health? So many, as you can see in the route, food security and food safety, water and sanitation, hygiene, urbanization, clean energy and solutions, policy, sustainable agriculture, antimicrobial resistance, biosecurity, climate change, biotechnology, zoonotic disease management, and disease surveillance and occupational health. That's all the area that we focus within the One Health. And who will be involved? Many, like I just mentioned before, that comparative medicine, social science, ecology, engineering, earth science, private sector, politics, and many more that will be involved in the One Health. So now what we can do for preventing future pandemic, what we could do more. So the figure here, so that we have to forecasting red need and early detection, rapid response, and control the benefit of the animal, control the benefit of the people. That is what we have to do to prevent the future pandemic. So foster coordinated interdisciplinary response across human, animal, and environmental health, strengthening the environment dimension of the One Health approach and leveraging innovation and new technology. So here we see two different dimensions of the One Health paradigm shift. Downstream reactive approach to the upstream approach active. Downstream approach in discipline silos, we can see that pathogen circulating in animal. First, we have to solve this problem. Then we can prevent the disease emerge and the disease infect in the human population. So for the under, we have to control the measure in the animal population and prevent the transition and prevent emergence. And finally, we can manage the disease and infection in the human. So that is one more time we have to think about what we can control in the animal health that it will help to prevent the disease for the human. And here, one more, we can see that what we will do with the animal to protect the animal health, what we will do. We improve overall animal health, thereby can be economic health. And we provide the link community-based mapping of common animal disease problem to facilitate early detection and intervention of the emerging and re-emerging animal pathogen and disease threat. Improve food security and monitor for foodborne disease. Reduce inappropriate antibiotic use and integrate animal, plant, and human disease problem at the data output and collection level. For the human health, what we do? We provide basic health advice on select primary healthcare conditions. We promote early detection of human endemic and epidemic health threat. Document and water and food source and food store preparation and identify overlap with animal and plant health. Collect information at the household level on squat, disposal of human, animal, and crop waste. Document the use of the pesticide and potential environmental toxin. Collect data to identify healthcare gap in community, human, animal, and plant. For the environment, what will we do? We understand the agriculture practice, water use, planting and storage crop. We establish the system for early identification of plant or crop disease. We document pesticide, fertilizer, and toxin used for crop agriculture, including organic methods, and identify the document common pathogen infestation or growth disorder of the crop, and we provide selling community-based mapping and commune agricultural problem to enable early detection and intervention. So we have a lot of effort in the global level. We establish and have many associations working together to combat the disease. Like for the climate change, we established the Paris Agreement on the Climate Change Effect, November 2017. Then UN Framework for the One Health or Global Health Security Agenda, etc. And now I go to the One Health Workforce Development. It is one of the organization or one of the action to develop the general human resource for the future. What is the One Health Network focus on? It is a focus on outbreak response, community outreach, and field-based learning. As we may know that One Health Workforce Next Generation, we have the support from USAID, and it was go through 3 periods. We have EPT1 from 2009-2014, and EPT2 from 2014-2019. And now we ongoing the One Health Workforce Next Generation from the 2019-2024. And Sihun, standing for Southeast Asia One Health University Network. And the Sihun established from the 2011. From the beginning, we only have four founding countries. It is Thailand, Malaysia, Indonesia, and Vietnam. But now it's going up to 8 Southeast Asia countries. That means we expanded to the other four countries. It is Cambodia, Laos, Myanmar, and Philippines. And now we also involve the 6 universities from Taiwan to be involved in the network. And the mission of our project is improve the workforce capacity in target country to prevent, detect, and respond to the threat posed by infectious disease and zoonosis disease. The project objective, we focus on 5 areas. First one is the workforce engagement. We support the One Health Network to engage with the government, academia, and other key partners in defining One Health workforce needs. The second one is a student training. We support the One Health Network to assist government ministries to train the future One Health workforce. And the third one is a professional training. We support the One Health Network to assist the government ministry to train the current One Health workforce. And the fourth one is a faculty development. So the Sihun support the university in strengthening the faculty capacity for One Health teaching research and community outreach for the One Health Network. And the last one is organizational development. Position the One Health Network as a long-term sustainable leader in One Health. That is a 5 main objective of the project. And we apply multi-sectoral engagement, education and training, and institution strengthening. That is a 3 main approach. And for the One Health Workforce Academy, you can look at the website with the link I show in the screen. And here we also can see the Sihun for the Southeast Asia and Afrohun for Africa. And through the One Health core competency, we work together to make the One Health core competency and One Health module for different kind of training for undergraduate or postgraduate or for the in-service training. For the core competency, One Health core competency, we create the 7 core competency module, including collaboration and partnership, communication and informatics, culture, belief, value and ethics, and leadership, management, policy, advocacy and regulation, and system thinking. And besides the 7 core competency module, we also have a 7 technical module, like One Health concept and knowledge, fundamental to infectious disease management, epidemiology and risk analysis, fundamental and public health, ecosystem health, and behavior change. So every country, every university, when based on this core competency and this technical module, they can adapt or they can revise to make it more appropriate for every country, for every university, for different level of the training. The way that we apply different methods on the training, like a case study, experimental, or field observation, or game, or group project, or peer teaching, or role play, or self-assessment, or problem-based learning. Actually, we very diversify the method during we do the training. And now, the last part, I would like to share very quick with you some example of One Health application in Vietnam. So we have a AMR project that some antimicrobial used to treat infection in animal are the same as those used for human. That's why it makes the antimicrobial resistant. So a One Health approach to stop overuse to reduce antimicrobial resistance. That is one of the examples that we do in Vietnam. We do the training and we do the monitoring system, or we organize a campaign to talk about the AMR. And we also make a design, apply One Health to take the AMR. So what we want to reduce the use of antibiotics in the animal, including the improved control on antibiotic critical for human use. So how? We assess likely effectiveness and feasibility of ban on the use of medical important antibacterial agents to grow promotion in livestock and drug critical for human treatment, where feasible, introduce and enforcement and require purchase by the prescription only. As you may know that in Vietnam, not only for the animal, but for the human, whenever you get sick, you can go straight to the drugstore and get any medicine you can. So you, without the prescription, you can buy antibiotic very easily. So we have to do some kind of the project like that to give the information for the consumer and also for the pharmaceutical. Or we also have the One Health approach to managing zoonotic agents with the pandemic potential that are especially in the wildlife. We also have some project. We work with the MOA or MAS or with the some organization like USAID or FAO. And we also have a One Health approach for managing human disease in emerging zoonotic origins. This also, we established the steering committee and we define the role of different ministry, and we also train the people to work in this field, and we get the support from different organizations like CDC, USAID, FAO, or WHO. So One Health is working together, national, international, and human health, animal health, environmental health, and multidiscipline. We need to work together to make the One Health collaboration. So finally, One Health is an approach that can only be successful if it maintains partnership across various professional sector and engage stakeholders within the human, animal, and environment category. So that is all for my presentation, and thank you for your listening. If you have any questions, then I will.
Yes, thank you, Professor Lay. That was an amazing information-dense presentation. So for those of you who are listening, and even maybe for those who have not had a chance to listen to it, we will be posting this online, and hopefully we can have your slides also, because there was a lot of information you shared with us. Really, I won't even try to summarize it because, you know, it was so much to go through. But the one thing, I mean, you know, it was great the way you laid it out. You talked about the concepts of it, then you gave very concrete suggestions of what one can do. And then you gave, you know, again, examples from Vietnam of what is happening on the ground. For me, the one thing that kind of was present on every single slide is how, you know, this whole approach and even just the situation we are in needs a multidisciplinary and really systems kind of approach to it. Otherwise, we are never going to, you know, be able to tackle any of these problems. So that was really on every slide. It was like, multidisciplinary systems thinking in many different ways. So that was really, you know, an important message that obviously came through. The one other thing before we get to the questions, I'd like to just make a comment that, you know, I think as scientists and as practitioners of One Health, in the One Health field, in the public health field, We are all, even if we were not previously bought into this idea of systems thinking and, you know, multidisciplinary approaches, I think by now we are. What about our politicians? You know, I think the politics, not that they, I'm sure they understand it, but maybe from, you know, other political considerations, they sometimes adopt it and sometimes maybe don't adopt it as much. So maybe we have to just, this is not really a question, just a comment that kept coming to my mind as you were talking, is we, the one other thing we can do as civil society people, you know, whether we are scientists, whether we are a doctor, whether we are, you know, a researcher, you know, anyone, someone who's gathering data, maybe our kind of civil duty is to elect politicians and leaders who advocate and really believe these views, and then also hold them accountable to implement them, because I think we as a kind of global society will suffer if we, you know, in our own individual countries are not doing that. So really that was kind of the message that was going through my mind all the time. We've all been talking, you know, we SDGHI hosted a webinar series in June 2020, I think, where we talked about looking forward, looking back and looking forward, where we took three very, you know, long sessions to go through exactly what you presented, you know, in this 1 hour. So that's great to have that. So let's turn to the questions. We have one which says, one of our viewers says, thank you very much for your presentation. You haven't talked much about mental health and well-being. How is mental health integrated into the One Health approach? And is there any particular focus on mental health?
Yes, that is also very interesting question, because not only the when we talk about the One Health, but everything related to the human, that is mental health. Mental health is very, very important. And we know that everything can be can affect our mental health problem. So for example, climate change, it also caused a lot of problem to the mental. And as in the collaboration in One Health issue that we mentioned about the medicine, public health, veterinary medicine, and the political. So mental health is one of the issues that make the people feel happy or not happy with the job we did as well. So the mental health is one of the components of the human health, and everything affect to the human health can be looked at the aspect of the mental health. So when we do the intervention, we have to think about what is health. Health is a satisfaction of the physical and mental health. So when we talk about the mental health, always physical health and mental health. So if we want to focus on the mental health, maybe we need to have another webinar to talk more about it. But it's really, really important. I agree with you.
Yeah, great. Yes. Well, I think each one of these topics could kind of have another webinar, but that's what you did a great job of, bringing them all together. This.
Yeah.
Turn to us. Another questions we've got. Thank you for an informative talk. You have mentioned about multi-drug resistance bacteria. May I ask if we are considering phage therapy against MDR infections on humans, animals, and plants in the context of One Health?
Yeah, so when we talk about the infection in the context of the One Health, so here we have to think about the, like in the slide I just showed you, for the human health, we have a different factor effect to the human health. And for the animal health, we also have a different factor effect to the animal health. And environment health also. And some it may be cross to each other, and some it may be typical only for the human and typical only for the animal, but some it is can be interactive between the human, animal, and environmental health. So we have to look at the different different lenses to see how we can integrate different partner and integrate different sector to solve the problem that we can have both for animal and human. So In this case, the politician is a very, very important because we cannot successful without the involvement of the leader, the politician, people. Yeah.
Okay, thank you for that. So another question we have, which is, says, in your experience, how can the issue of AMR be communicated more effectively to the general public? Or is it more of a regulatory issue?
Yes. Because I have not much time to talk about the AMR, but it is the big problem in Vietnam, and I don't know how about in Singapore, but maybe not as bad as in Vietnam, like in the talk I just mentioned to you, that not only the policy is not good enough to have the people obey on the regulation, because sometimes the regulation is there, but bring it into the real life, it is not good. That's why everywhere in Vietnam, you see the medicine, people can get medicine everywhere in the drugstore without the description of the doctor. And besides that, the understand or the knowledge of people in this is very limited, because lack of the knowledge, that's why they just behave. Whenever the children get sick, they go straight to the drugstore and just ask a medicine. And then the pharmaceutical just give any medicine then they bring to give the children without the advice of the doctor. That is very, very bad. And also for the animal as well. For the animal even is a word, because no one care about what will be happen if the animal treated by different type of medicine, and the doses of the medicine, doses of antibiotic, never concerned about it. And they also not know that the animal, if we use an overdose of the antibiotic, it's in resistant in the meat that we consume, but no one know about it. I think that it's a lot of things have to do to improve AMR in Vietnam, especially.
Yeah. Right. I'm seeing our time, but I will ask this one more question that has come in. Outside of the One Health networks you presented, are there other important pathways or mechanisms you have identified for building country-to-country and regional collaborations? So in addition to the ones you've already mentioned in the presentation.
Yes, the One Health Workforce or One Health Network is only one example, because besides One Health Network, we have many other networks that connect country to country and university to university or university with other organizations. For example, we have a CMELTROMED in our region as well, or we have a different network like AFAIR. We also contact the different university working together to combat the pandemic. And also we work together on develop the scientific research. So I think that we have a more network to talk about, but in this presentation, I just focus on Southeast Asia One Health University Network that we already work together more than 10 years. So we start with only 10 universities, but now it go up to almost 100 universities in the region, in the network with the 8 countries.
Yeah. Okay, that's great to know that these networks are growing. And as we said earlier, you know, hopefully this is what will bring that change, much needed change. But with that, I will see that we are out of time, so I'm going to close it. I will make a plug before I close it and thank the speaker. I will make a plug for our World One Health Congress, which is coming up in November 2022. As I mentioned in the introduction, Professor Lay with us is part of the organizing committee. The Institute SDGHI is the organizing committee for it. And we've just posted the link to the website. Registration is open. So all of you who are interested to know all the details, a lot more detail, we'll have a 4.5-day Congress on world on the One Health topics. We've also broadened it this year to really go beyond some of the more scientific topics that are usually covered in that Congress. to really look at it in clinical practice, to look at it in pandemic preparedness, to look at it from a biosecurity angle. So it's a very, very rich Congress coming up. So go to the website, register, we'll see you there. And Professor Leh, thank you so much for your presentation today. Really enjoyed it. And to the audience, thank you for being with us. To our organizing team, thanks for, as usual, seamlessly organizing this seminar, and see you next month in our April monthly seminar. Goodbye, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.